Yes, I'm here, and it's time. I asked for them, you gave them to me. It's Q&A time, so thanks to those of you that submitted your questions. You're following the show on Twitter, I'm assuming, which all of you should do, and hopefully have also smashed that subscribe button. If not, you should probably do both of those things now. I got a lot of questions this time. Not going to be able to answer all of them. Tried to pick some of the best and most interesting ones that captured my attention. Would seem to spark some of the more interesting conversations, so keep that in mind when you submit for future Q&As. Like, try to make that stuff interesting. Make it catch my eye and catch my attention. Let's go ahead and get started. Splash Bro Kieran kicks us off by asking, when you think about the fact that WWE almost fired John Cena in 2002 because they didn't give him anything to work with, do you ever think of other potential stars WWE released because they didn't give him anything to work with? Oh, no question. There's no doubt that happened over the years. Like, you have to sometimes give the right opportunities and give people opportunities and chances. And there's no question WWE at times doesn't do that. Can't see the forest through the trees. So it's absolutely happened. Sinner 51190. After totally sabotaging the Nexus in 2010, if WWE saw the error in their ways and returned to the mentality of making the wrestlers as big as they possibly could have been, how big do you believe CM Punk would have become if they actually tried in 2011-2012? If they actually legitimately tried, like, they would have had to have gone all the way with that story. I'm not convinced that they had the courage to do it. And what I mean by that is you would have had to have CM Punk appear in Japan. CM Punk appear in Ring of Honor. CM Punk appear all over the place in the independent scene. CM Punk appearing out in front of shows that the WWE is doing at venues and talking about how he's the real WWE champion. Have him appear on Impact. And you're going to say, the WWE would have never done that. Well, yeah, you're probably right. That's kind of the point. But the reality is, if you were going to make him as big as possible, that's the type of stuff you're going to do. And then if you say, well, Impact, TNA wouldn't have had CM Punk. You're telling me that TNA wouldn't let CM Punk come on in the middle of a hot storyline where he's talking about he's the real WWE champion? As much of a ratings whore as TNA and in particular Dixie Carter were, you're crazy if you think they wouldn't have let him on. Like, I would have not only let him on, but I would have had him defending that title at these shows. Defend at Wrestle Kingdom. Defend at Bound for Glory. Defend at Final Battle. Like, you play that shit out for months. You play that shit out for months. And you have WWE do everything they can to completely and totally ignore it. Like, after the first night after Money in the Bank, you address it and you say, he's done and he's never here again. Like, you let the rest of the world kind of take it over for the next few months. He could have been big. It could have gotten to the point where he would have had a spot at the top where if they would have let him, he could have been bigger than Cena. There's no question about it at that time, especially. Because there was plenty of Cena fatigue. That shit was done and played out. People would have wanted something fresh and something different. So, and maybe by that time you could have convinced Austin to say, you know what? I'm going to throw enough money at you that you're going to find enough courage to do one more fucking match and you can actually put somebody over because it's not going to hurt you. You're going to be working with the hottest guy. Like, you could have done it, and then you could have even brought him back in early 2012, right around Royal Rumble time, and have Paul Heyman be his fucking advocate and all this other shit. You could have even sat there and done some shit where when you brought in Brock Lesnar, it wasn't to send him at fucking John Cena. You bring in Brock Lesnar because you're sending him at CM Punk because it's the WWE striking back against CM Punk. You could have Paul Heyman turn on him. You could have done so many fucking different things. It's frustrating to think about, frankly. CM fucking Goof. If Orton and Cena were to happen at WrestleMania, and possibly for the vacant WWE World Heavyweight Championship, should Orton have another couple of brief world title reigns so that he too can have 16 world title reigns so that Cena-Orton match can have the backdrop of who will win their 17th World Heavyweight Championship first? Oh, into my veins! Yes! Yes, yes, yes! A million times fucking yes! God, that would be fantastic. Shaji underscore Ahmed, rank these 8 subjects from most to least detrimental to the WWE's success and future. WWE going public, the Invisible Man scandal 2007, WWE buying out WCW, John Cena, WWE going PG, Dirt Cheeks, Smart Wrestling Fans, Rock leaving Hollywood, leaving for Hollywood. Oh my, that's a lot. Some really, really good ones. From most to least detrimental to WWE success and their future. I would put the Dirt Sheets and the Smart Wrestling Fans lower on the order. There are times they're frustrating. There are times that they don't help. There are times they make things worse. Absolutely. But at least they're still there, and at least they're generating some type of activity around the product, some type of discussion points around the product, some type of interest around the product. So I would put them probably 7 and 8. When I look at most detrimental to the success in the future, I put Rock going to Hollywood 6 because, yeah, that was a big deal, but that wasn't the be-all, end-all by any stretch of the imagination. So I'd put that 6, which leaves your top 5. I'll go the Benoit scandal. No. Yeah, I'll go the Benoit scandal 5 because that led to 4, which was WWE going PG. Three, WWE buying out WCW because that lack of competition has hurt them in the long term because Vince lost his vision. He lost his direction. He lost his purpose, and he's never gathered it back. Number 2 is John Cena. Yeah, that detrimental to their success and their future. Because they served everything up on a platter for him for a decade that there was nothing left when he decided, oh, I want to go be like The Rock and do fucking movies. And then number 1 is WWE going public. It has never quite fully been the same, especially once you got out of the Attitude Era. Like, the whole approach and the philosophy of the company changed, and not in a good way. DeMarcus Flowers, now that the crowds are returning, do you think WWE will be bringing back some of those names they released this year? Maybe in some cases, yes, but I don't think that's a guarantee. LA_1214_UN, there's apparently a popular opinion among certain wrestling fans today about the current general style being much more safe than 15, 20 years ago when chair shots to the head and being stiff overall happened more often. Thoughts. I want to just immediately shit on that and say that's stupid. I want to also say, though, if you only have to work maybe 150, 180 days a year as opposed to 250 or 300, you're probably going to have the ability to generally take better care of your body, which even includes allowing you to take more risks and more idiotic bumps and still in general feel safer. The chair shots not going to the head. It's not like it happened in every match, but certainly. But then you look at all these spots that all these other idiots are doing, and you say, well, damn, yeah, you're not getting chair shots to the head, but you're getting dropped in your head, you're getting dropped on your neck, and you're doing all this other dumb, reckless, stupid crap. The real answer here to me, and it's the real answer, is that is unclear and incomplete and unable to determine at this time. When people say, well, it's so much safer. How do you fucking know? Well, we're not all dropping dead in our 50s and 60s. How do you know? You're not in your 50s and 60s. Do I anticipate these guys and gals that are working now and have worked over the past 10, 15 years will live longer than the previous generations because they won't be so roided and coked and somed up? Yes, I do. But there's also a piece of quality of life. Like some of these wrestlers, their stars burn bright and then they're gone by 60, maybe 65. You know, some of these guys and gals may live into their 70s or their 80s, but what's the second half of their life going to look like? Because they're doing a lot of dumb, reckless shit. So the reality is, it's inconvenient for everybody, but we don't fucking know. We could think we know, we can project or predict, but we don't know. And anybody that says they do know, and that's especially coming from fans that are aligned with the modern style that they've wanted to see for so long because they think this is the type of shit that's going to take wrestling to the next level, which they're fucking wrong. It won't. And it's being proven that it's not. But they don't want to admit that it's not because if they do that, then they admit that they're wrong and they didn't know what the hell they're talking about. But the reality is that's a really dumb talking point. It needs to stop because you just don't have the evidence to support it one way or another at this point. S-Bear 504. What match, in your opinion, ruined kayfabe more? Taker versus Mankind in Hell in a Cell, or Dudley's versus Edge and Christian in the Hardys TLC 2. Why would either one of those matches ruin kayfabe more? Perhaps, if anything, it's probably Taker and Mankind, but so many other things that blew the roof off of it, the kayfabe piece, like, I don't think either one of those matches really applies. Killink underscore Mukahid. Should John Cena come back as a heel with an anti-USA attitude and as a supporter of the Chinese regime? Could this work, and how would you book it? He should absolutely come back as a heel. He should absolutely come back as some fucking corporate stooge, like, I'm just doing this for money. I'm a Hollywood guy now. I was in the Fast Nine. Like, if he comes back and he tries to get people, other than the dipshit clowns that will be happy to see him for some reason, and the dumbass kids, like, if you really think about it, there is no more appeal to John Cena being a babyface in the traditional, we're going to force him down your throat and you still hate him, but we'll consider him a hero crap. Like, he should be a, I'm doing this for the money. I don't have to do this. I don't even really want to do this. But I could do this better than any of you and still be a big movie star and all that other shit. Like, some great value version of the Hollywood Rock from 2003 is exactly what the hell John Cena should be coming back as. He should not be coming back as that hustle, loyalty, respect dude. And if he does, everybody should fart at that, because that's stupid. If he can be a villain in movies, he can be a villain on WWE TV. Tamiba 2. What standard moves do you think would be the most painful? Not high spots like the Mankind Hell in a Cell fall, but moves finishers you'd be expected to take often. Standard moves and finishers are two different things, so I'm going to focus on the standard move piece. The move that I think should be sold way more than it does, and it just gets thrown in there as a piece of a chain wrestling and has no impact, is the body slam. Everybody knows how thin the rings are. They know that landing on that shit hurts. So emphasize that. Pump that up. Sell the fucking body slam a little bit. Now, if you really want people to buy into what you're doing, make them believe. Sell what you're doing having impact and meaning. Like, that type of shit should hurt. That, to me, is one move. It's a standard move that should be very painful that everybody can believe in. Jeremy Adams 04. If the news would have been true about Cardi B being at SummerSlam, would it have been sad to see that she would have more charisma, likability, and mic skills than 80% of the roster? Charisma and mic skills are one thing. Likability? What the fuck is likable about Cardi B? Wasn't she the bitch that was sitting there pitching a fit about the national anthem or pitching a fit about this or that? But yet, lo and behold, when it came to her own fucking pocketbook, that dumb cunt sat there and did the Pepsi commercial during the Super Bowl. Same bitch, right? Same Cardi bitch that sat there and was bragging about how she drugged men so they get robbed and raped and everything else. Likeability, my fucking ass. Mr. Benzie, you have the book for AEW's women's division. Who is your women's champion and who your rising star? Women's champion, I'm perfectly fine with Britt Baker being women's champion right now. Rising star, Jade Cargill. Others that you should be emphasizing or focusing on, Red Velvet, if she could ever stop botching her way through fucking matches, that would be nice. A Thunder Rosa, I certainly want to strongly feature a Serena Deeb because she's just so goddamn good. Those would be some of the ladies that I'd be strongly featuring. EJ Dennis 96, which was the better Rock feud, Mankind in 98 and 99 or Triple H in 2000? For my money, personally, my opinion, I enjoyed Mankind a lot more. There were more layers to it. There were more elements to it. It went in different directions. That was always the better one to me. Dave 123 underscore 456, do you miss watching TNA when it was good, and do you think AEW will ever be as good as TNA was back then? I miss TNA every day. I miss the old TNA. I really, really do. And it'll never be back again. As far as AEW being as good as TNA back then, depends on how you define good. From a television rating standpoint, they're never going to draw, I can't see, like what TNA used to draw consistently in terms of their rating and viewership numbers. But I also look at AEW and say, their ability to take the viewers that they have and convert a decent percentage of them into pay-per-view buyers every 3 months is pretty impressive, and that's something that never happened and never translated for TNA because they were so focused on the TV product. They were so focused on, oh my God, the rating dropped a tenth of a point. We got to sit there and freak out. Bring back Sting. Do a title change on TV. Like they always forsaken the pay-per-view for the TV product. AEW doesn't do that. So it's different. Much different. A little DJ boy, do you think Vince McMahon is something against NXT? Surely NXT do get a lot of their guys over or to stand out. But for example, to call up guys like Karrion Kross and Keith Lee and completely bury them in a presentation aspect sure seems like a hit job. I'm not sure if it's as much of a hit job as it is a just doesn't know what the fuck they're doing type of thing. Because if it's like NXT is doing its own thing, which is part of the problem. It's supposed to be a developmental territory, a developmental brand. You should be developing them for the main roster, which means you should be teaching them how to be main roster guys on the lower level. Now they come here and the visions aren't aligned and Vince is thinking something different. And again, WWE is only booking for one person and that's Vince McMahon. So you're doing this shit here. It doesn't matter if it doesn't translate here. That's the problem. So I don't know if it's so much of having something against NXT. I think it's more about the fact that what NXT is trying to do and what Vince is trying to do are sometimes two different things and they don't connect and there's not a symmetry there and that creates a lot of the problems. Rick Styles, 1985. If MJF isn't an AEW World Champion in a year, does he jump ship to WWE? Why would he? He's not going to get featured strongly in WWE. What the hell would make you think he would? If he's not world champion in a year, then that just means that company's being really stupid. But jumping ship to WWE, I don't know why the hell he would want to do that. Makes no sense to me. Daniel Sims underscore 23. If Brock Lesnar never left WWE in 2004, how much longer do you think he would have kept wrestling? Probably another couple of years, maybe 2 to 3. And then he would have probably taken a few years off and then realized, hey, I want to make some more money before I retire. So he would have then come back and wrestled some more. I think another 2 to 3 years, especially with him at the top, because he was certainly going to be at the top. He was their next big thing. He was their next dude. James Isabel, 20. Who would you have winning in a three-way horse race? Karen Jarrett, the horse-faced bitch of a wife? Madison or Carmella? Only one could be the noble steed. Well, Madison Rayne is a goat, not a horse. So she can't win a horse race. Carmella? No. There's only one noble steed, and that is horse-faced bitch of a wife. Karen Jarrett all fucking day. Especially if you give her her carrots and oats. She's blowing these folks away. Mo Benny 99. You said in the past that you don't like triple threat matches, but why is that? Why don't you like them? Because I think at times it's lazy booking, lazy writing, lazy producing. For me, when you start talking about the triple threat, like, it's a lot of, hey, these two are going to go at it because this dude's having a 5-minute rest, or these two are going to go have it because this dude's having a 5-minute rest. It crosses too many wires, does too many things. I just don't like it in general. I think it's stupid. Every once in a while, you see a really, really good one. But generally, I hate triple threats and fatal four ways and things like that. I really do. Surgeon D, when Bray Wyatt returns, who should he feud with and why would it be with his child support? Oh, fucking Jesus. Oh, yes, 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 yes. Or even better, it's Bray Wyatt versus The Fiend over child support. You put the child support papers above the ring at SummerSlam. It'd be the first match. Oh no, and the twist is whoever climbs the ladder first, they have to pay the child support. Man, you never watch two people try to... No. But, oh, man, can you fucking imagine Bray Wyatt versus The Fiend over who knocked up JoJo and who's got to pay that child support? Now, that would be a fucking blood feud. If you want something that people can believe in, you want something that the fellas would buy, this shit would be relatable. This shit would be magnificent and fantastic. Hell yeah. Well, anyways, I think I've gotten to the end of the Q&A questions I'm going to answer this week. So I thank all of you again for submitting your questions. Make sure you can follow the show on Twitter. Smash that subscribe button. I'll do a Q&A probably in another week or so. I'm out.